Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me, yeah. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me. Ooh, 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 ooh. And I'm feeling good.
Are you feeling good? Who's feeling good today?
You know how I feel.
Who's feeling good today?
River running free. You know how I feel. Blossom on the tree. You know how I feel.
New dawn. It's a new day.
It's a new life for me.
And I'm feeling good. Gary, are you feeling good today?
Dragonfly out in the sun. You know what how I mean. Butterflies all having fun, you know what I mean. Sleep in peace when day is done, that's what I mean. And this old world is a new world and a bold world.
If you don't feel like it's a new day, you're in the wrong place. I woke up with that on my mind this morning. Because there's just something about claiming the day, about making it happen and being liberated enough to say, this is mine, this is my moment. This is my moment. And if we as a movement in this day and in this time can't make that statement, I don't even want to finish that sentence. We are going to make this happen. It's, you know, this old world is a new world. It's a bold world. We're feeling good. We're feeling mighty and bold at ARC. And that's why we're putting forth a vision for a world that we want to create. And there are leaders in this room who've already moved that vision, and it's time to take it to the next step. But I just want to pause for a little second, and, you know, there's been a lot of talk about, you know, this African-American man who's made it to the presidency, but there's been a lot of groundwork for that and a lot of other firsts. And we have another one in the room today that I think we need to acknowledge. There's a sister who was the first African-American woman in Parliament in Canada who's with us today. Jean Augustine. Thank you, sister. Compact for racial justice is more than just some paper words for us at ARC. You know, as a movement, we can really kill some trees, right? and talk some talk. It's something that holds great meaning to us. It's our plan, yes, for fairness and unity. It's, yes, our agenda to advance racial equity in all of these issues we care about. Yes, it's a tool to talk about race in a new and different way, to say that we can be proactive and make a new country. But it's much more than all of these things. It's a sacred promise that we hold for ourselves, our families, our ancestors, and future generations, to build a society that suspects, that respects, and embraces all of us. is that's the promise. Recently, a friend of ours said that in this period may be one where the possibilities are outrunning our imagination. Where the possibilities may be outrunning our imaginations. Have we been entrenched so long in defensive fights and trying to hold on to what little we have that we can't imagine a world we want and then go for it? I can't think that way, and I can't believe that you do either. So we have this concern at the Applied Research Center, and creating the Compact for Racial Justice was our way of saying there is no going back. There's only moving forward. And we decided to carve out some time this morning to play a little catch-up with the imagination. So if in this moment in history is one that holds within it the potential to radically transform this country, and I say those words not lightly, to radically transform this country, how do we make the most of it? How do we make the most of this new day? So essentially, the Compact for Racial Justice is about that, and this panel today is also about making the most of this new moment. So let's get on to the business of the panel. So accompanying my introduction to today's panel will be quotes from the Compact's preamble. And there's a short package in your registration packet that gives you a snippet of the Compact and the whole preamble. Our guests will speak in the order that they are being introduced this morning, and I'll follow it up with some Q&A to the audience. But first, let's begin with a quote from the preamble. Nothing could be more affirming to our individual and collective worth than our work to create a country that embodies the following. Our first panelist is Karin Wang, who is the Vice President of Programs at the Asian Pacific American Legal Center, which is a civil rights and legal service organization in Southern California. Karin has also directed APOLLOC's immigrant rights advocacy and helped file a civil rights complaint against Los Angeles County on behalf of a limited English speaker. The suit resulted in an awarding of $1.7 million back in benefits, so we can make it happen. Karin is also a member of the No on Proposition 8 campaign and was one of several lawyers who filed an amicus brief in the California Supreme Court on behalf of 63 Asian American organizations in support of marriage equality. She will speak about civil rights today. LeeAnn Hall is the director of Northwest Federation of Community Organizations. Formed in 93, NIFCO is comprised of four Pacific Northwest community-based organizations, Idaho Community Action Network, Oregon Action, Montana's People's Action, and Washington Community Action Network. Collectively, they have over 65 years of organizational history and have done work in areas including healthcare, housing, taxes, living wages, utility, and education. She will speak about healthcare reform in this new age. John H. Jackson is the president and CEO of the Schott Foundation for Public Education. In his role, Dr. Jackson leads the foundation's effort to ensure high quality public education for all students, regardless of race or gender. He joined the Schott Foundation after 7 productive years at the National NAACP as Chief Policy Officer and also as National Director of Education. He's also served as an adjunct professor of race, gender, and public policy at Georgetown Public Policy Institute. Moving a national public education agenda would be the focus of his remarks today. Andrea Batista Schlesinger is the Executive Director of the Drum Major Institute, a progressive policy institute and national impact. Andrea studied public policy at the University of Chicago. Before DMI, she directed a national campaign to engage college students in the discussion on the future of Social Security for the Pew Charitable Trust. She was named a 40 under 40 rising star by Crain's New York Business in 2007. Today, she will speak about the economy and how we will move forward there. And finally, we have Rinku Sen, who is the president and the executive director of the Applied Research Center and publisher of Color Lines magazine. Her organizing has included fighting around race, gender, and class discrimination issues. And she was this year's Utney's visionaries who are changing the world. Her latest book, The Accidental American, Immigration and Citizenship in the Age of Globalization, vividly illustrates the challenges and contradiction of U.S. immigration policy. Today, of course, she will speak about immigration. So let's begin today's panel with Karin.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. I actually thought I was going to go last because I was at this end. So I hope you'll forgive me. I was hoping to be able to say ditto to everybody else. It's a real privilege to be here this morning, and it's really exciting in this that, as Tammy said, we're in a new day and age. I am extremely excited, although I am. It is tempered by the California elections, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that at the very end. I'm not going to go through in detail what is in the written documents around the civil rights issues that we laid forth, but I wanted to just highlight a couple of things. First of all, it is a whole new world, and I think for civil rights, anyone who has worked on or is working on civil rights, this is really, this coming administration starting in January is the best opportunity we've had in at least a generation to reinvigorate the federal level commitment to civil rights. It is a really amazing time. I know we have to temper that with what is practical and doable, but it is the best chance we've had in a really long time. It is the first time, I think, in more than 20 years that we are going to have an administration that has no incumbent president, no incumbent vice president. So, not only did our president-elect campaign on the slogan of change, but it is really a new day and age. And so there is a lot of hope there. You know, from a civil rights perspective, and I come from a civil rights legal organization, it's been a real struggle to move civil rights in sort of the legal and policy spheres in recent years. I'm going to just comment on a couple of things that we wrote about. One is that there is, in this current administration, the new administration has tremendous opportunities in a lot of places, but in two important ways that I want to highlight. One is with the courts. For many of us, and even for us who are lawyers in the room, the courts are not necessarily part of our daily, experience. And so we tend to think more of the protests in the streets and, you know, what the legislature is doing. But the courts really have an important role. And what's been unfortunate is that the role of the courts in the past has been to move civil rights forward. If you look at the 60s and the 70s, the courts played a tremendous role in expanding civil rights protections. And actually, even as far back as like the 40s and 50s, they were oftentimes ahead of where the public was. And that is the role of the courts, to ensure that no group is oppressed and to ensure that the Constitution applies to all groups. As I don't think I need to tell this room that we have a lot of concerns with the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court is the ultimate arbiter of many of our civil rights issues in our nation. And we have, at this point, the three youngest Supreme Court, the most recent Supreme Court appointees, are not friends of racial justice, not friends of social justice. And I know that goes without saying in this room. What's interesting is that five of the nine justices on the U.S. Supreme Court are now 70 years or older. As most of you know from following any news in the last few years, it is quite likely that one or two or more will step down in the next few years. And so there is a general expectation that President-elect Obama will have a chance to appoint at least two Supreme Court justices, and that is going to be significant. Supreme Court justices, yes. I have to say that's the biggest motivating factor for me in a lot of ways, because Supreme Court justices, they have long tenures. The average tenure for Supreme Court justice, believe it or not, is 25 years. And that's actually six presidential administrations. So whoever gets appointed can be on that bench for decades. And so that is incredibly important. But the other thing we also have to mobilize around, because there's not so much at the community we can do specifically with the Supreme Court justices. There's a political process that plays out. But what people forget is that for those of us that look at civil rights as a daily issue, the lawsuits that we file get filed at the lower court level. Very few cases make it to the Supreme Court. And we have just as bad justices on racial and social justice at the lower levels. And so we do need to ensure that judges that get appointed in and that the next administration is held accountable to appointing judges who can balance the slew of judges that have been appointed in recent years who have no sympathy or empathy for racial and social justice, for people who are poor, who are working class. So the judges all across the board, not just the Supreme Court, are a key place for this administration to make a huge difference on civil rights. Because then when we bring our lawsuits here in California and the federal courts, we won't be afraid that we're going to end up with a terrible decision that we have to live with for the next few decades. And so that is one of our key issues. The other thing I wanted to mention is that besides the role of the courts in civil rights, the role of the federal government is incredibly important in implementing whatever laws we actually have. And so the challenge there is that the agencies charged with doing that in our federal government have really fallen down on the job over the past decade and actually probably longer than that. So there are two places where we're hopeful that in this coming administration some significant changes will happen. One is with the U.S. Department of Justice. They are the law, they're basically the law office for the nation, for the federal government. And specifically, the Civil Rights Division was created in, I believe, the mid to late 1950s as civil rights was sweeping the nation. And its original mission was to enforce, to protect civil rights. If you look at what the Department of Justice does now, you'd be really hard-pressed to actually figure out that that was what the mission of the Department of Justice. So what we're hopeful for and what we need to hold the new administration accountable for is that the Department of Justice reprioritizes its original mission, that it champions those who are vulnerable, and challenges systemic discrimination, which is what it's not doing. It's currently going after things like championing things like freedom of religion versus police abuse in police departments across the country. They're also, we also, like the courts, need to remember it's not just the Department of Justice, but we actually have federal agency, cabinet agency, Department of Health, Department of Education, Department of Labor. They all have their own civil rights agencies, and many of them have lost funding over the years so that at most they have a handful of people in D.C. trying to enforce civil rights across a nation of 50 states. Those agencies need to be refunded, and some of them need to get their civil rights missions back. I spent 2 years at the Department of Health and Human Services Civil Rights Office, and at that time that civil rights office was being handed the mandate of enforcing privacy laws. And while those privacy laws are important, we are actually seeing privacy laws trumping civil rights enforcement in health and human services programs. I know I'm about out of time. I actually wanted to make one comment that is actually not in the compact. I actually feel like it's impossible to talk about moving civil rights forward without talking about Proposition 8. And I do want to say, I know I was introduced as being part of the No on 8 campaign committee. I wanted to clarify that although I was involved in that and we did lose, I was actually focused on working in communities of color, especially Asian American immigrant communities in Los Angeles. And the main thing I wanted to tell folks is that we have civil rights struggles not only at the national level, but we have them here at the state level. And if you have not looked at what happened with Proposition 8, you, all of us as people of color, as social and racial justice activists, have to be worried. What we just passed here in California, not we, the people in the room, but the state of California, has passed a change to the state constitution. And as of yesterday, five racial justice groups, my organization, Asian Pacific American Legal Center, the NAACP, and the NAACP Legal Defense Fund, MALDEF, and Equal Justice Society based here in San Francisco, we have sued independently of the gay rights group in the California Supreme Court, asking the Supreme Court to invalidate Proposition 8 because it is a threat to the rights of all minority groups. And And the reason I bring this up is because I don't think I need to tell the folks in this room, but we need to make sure our communities understand that all social justice struggles are intertwined. I'm sorry I missed the conversation that started yesterday around Proposition 8. I'm sure it's very rich. We have a lot of work to do. But I just wanted to underscore that if you don't already know this, we have to push back on Prop 8, not just through the protests that are happening this morning and elsewhere, but we filed this lawsuit because what Prop 8 does now, it says that a bare majority of voters can strip a protected class of minorities of their fundamental rights. And so on top of the national work we have to do, we have to push back on this here in California. And I'll close with that. Thank you.
Hi, my name's LeeAnn Hall, and I'm with the Northwest Federation of Community Organizations and here today talking about health justice. As an organizer, the success of anything is measured in the changes of the lives of the people that I work with in neighborhoods. And so that's where I want to start my talking about what health justice means to me and looking forward. In 2005, Roy Martinez, a member of Idaho Community Action Network, was hoeing onions bent over with a 10-inch knife in a hot field in Idaho. Unable to leave the fields because of the way farm workers work, to wash his hands and have lunch, he sat down to eat his burrito with the 29 other workers in the fields, and after lunch, all of them became violently ill after ingesting 3 pesticides they didn't know had been sprayed the night before on the fields. Health workers and the fire department arrived on the scene, made people strip naked in front of the main highway that goes east-west through the state, sprayed them off with water hoses, and took them to West Valley Hospital. Later, we found out that the community referred to this as Death Valley Hospital. The hospital had nobody on staff able to translate for people, so one of the people who was ill, Maria, the only person who was bilingual, began translating for everybody else who was there. No one had insurance. They were all treated and released. They had difficulty getting follow-up, and Roy, to this day, still cannot work. It's stories like this that really highlight the complexity of what we mean by health and healthcare in America. And there are many more. They take many shapes. But they enable us to really look differently at the healthcare conversation in the community rather than the one sometimes that we see on TV. So unpacking this story a little bit, what we can see is that Roy's health was not only dependent on whether or not he had insurance, but the working conditions that he worked in, the pesticides that he, environmental degradation that he was exposed to, and the cultural barriers that he experienced once he made his way into the hospital. So our goal in the end, in terms of reforming healthcare, has to really look at what are the health outcomes of everybody. Are we healthier at the end of the day? And to be able to do this, we need to not only address whether people have health insurance, which is the dominant frame of the conversation around health care in America today, but we have to look at the causes of what gives rise to inequities in health care, which is the economic and social determinants of health. And what we mean by that is how we work and live and what we're exposed to. And we all know that if you're poor and a person of color, you're much more likely to live in worse conditions and be paid less. And all of those things are going to impact how long you live and how sick you are during your life. So what we need to do is to stretch. There really is a political moment that's very exciting right now where healthcare is front and forward on the agenda. And we need to stretch out that political moment. As a supervisor once said to me, that's good, but it's not good enough. That's what I feel about our conversation about health insurance today. Yes, we need a campaign across this country to ensure that every single person living here has access to health insurance, but it's great, but it's insufficient to get us where we want. And even when we put on our racial lenses and look at that fight for insurance, we need to ask some hard questions. Does universal coverage, does everybody really mean everybody when politicians are standing up and talking about health care? Or are they going to leave immigrants behind? This is the big question, I think, in many people's mind across the country as we move forward looking at universal coverage. The thing that nobody wants to talk about is, will immigrants be covered in this program? We need to draw the line and ensure that immigrants are covered. On Friday night, we heard about Indian Health Services. Indian Health Services have been on the chopping block of the Bush administration, proposed to entirely defund a commitment that have been made to the tribes across this country for many, many years. We need to ensure that Indian Health Services are fully funded, that urban health clinics are fully funded, and that services improve in those communities across the country. In addition, we need to have a public option, not just private options for healthcare, but a government sponsor, just like the government's investing in the banks. We need to see the government investing in healthcare, and we need a public option, but we need to look deeply at the quality of care that will be delivered through that public option. We need to make sure that when you're actually sick and you go to get help, that whatever you have is covered in that package, that prevention and medicine and all those other things are included in that notion of health insurance. So insurance and the whole conversation about insurance is critical to us, but as I said, it's good, but not good enough. We need to go beyond to the root causes of health disparities in our community and to open up the healthcare conversation to look at the environmental and social preconditions that create bad health. So wages, working conditions, the environment, education, as we was noted earlier in this conference. If you don't have good math classes, even in second grade, the likelihood that you're going to be able to get the science background to move on and diversify our healthcare system is unlikely. We need to advance new tools to examine and have and to look at what's going on, what public policies are being passed, and say, what is the healthcare impact of these policies? So we want to advance health impact statements as a way of examining the racial disparities that could be outcomes of policies that public institutions are looking at passing. We need to call for new interagency cooperation where the environment folks looking at the environment, public health, and economic development work together to ensure that we have healthy communities and therefore healthy outcomes for people's health. This is going to require that we advance a strong movement that involves many, many people organizing at the local, state, and national level to call out the health disparities that we experience and to advance comprehensive solutions. Thank you.
I want to applaud Ark and Rinku for pulling together this very necessary and timely session, and all of you for being here at this moment, because I do think that there are a number of discussions and strategies that we need to begin to put some thought leadership around if we are truly going to make this the opportunity, take advantage of the opportunity that exists. So I want to thank Ark for the opportunity to share my perspectives on how I believe that we can provide all students access to a fair and substantive opportunity to learn through our public educational system. Now, perspectives are a dangerous thing. It's like the woman who got out of the shower and was looking in the mirror, asked her husband, she said, "You know, I feel like I'm gaining weight. What do you think?" He said, "I think you have good vision." Perspective can be a very dangerous thing when not appropriately focused. But I'm glad to have the opportunity today to talk about what I consider to be one of the most critical issues in our country, the education of our children, because there is a correlation between educational attainment and a community's economic base. correlation between educational attainment and a community's civic participation, voting, volunteerism, a correlation between educational attainment and incarceration. And in so many places and states across the country, the decisions are being made to incarcerate rather than educate. And this is an issue that as a community we have to begin to strategically address. There's clear data that indicates that we are all 99.6% the same. In fact, there are more genes to explain the variance in our eye color than our racial or ethnic differences. So to the degree that we're 99.6% the same, any variance that we see in educational performance is not caused by the racial or ethnic differences, but the social policies and social practices which lead to those differences. Our challenge becomes addressing those social policies and social practices, which it has been a part of a movement that has built over a number of years. Right here in 1945 in the Mendez case, where the League of United Latin American Citizens and the NAACP came together to fight against segregation in Orange County. The case was very significant in leading to Brown versus the Board of Education and making good case law to get the Supreme Court to say separate but equal was unconstitutional. But I will say that Brown wasn't a touchdown, it was a first down. Because in 1973, the Supreme Court was asked in San Antonio versus Rodriguez, is education a federally protected right? Is it a fundamental right in our country? And the Supreme Court said no. They said we will leave it up to the states to decide the type of educational systems that they will protect for the citizens and the children within their states. Since that point, we've had 43 adequacy and equity lawsuits in 43 states across the country. And those states have been, those cases have been tremendously expensive with very little results. As we look around the country and measure our impact by not those who are at the top, but those who are performing the worst, at the Schott Foundation, we highlight the performance of black males. Because in all but four states, black males are at the bottom of the performance indicators. And then the other four states, it's Latino males. So these populations have, in many respects, served as the yellow canaries for what is happening across the country in our educational system. Places like New York, which has the enrolls the largest number of black males, but has a 32% graduation rate. Places like Detroit, where there's a 20% graduation rate for black males. Indianapolis, 19% graduation rate. At a time when there are changing demographics that pretty much says that if we continue on this trend, our nation will no longer be globally competitive. So our challenge as we address this issue is not, it's not just an issue that impacts black and brown communities. It's an issue that impacts the entire nation as the demographics of our nation also change. How do we provide all students a fair and substantive opportunity to learn? We know that, and there's clear data that says when you provide a child access to early childhood education, highly effective teacher, and a college-bound curriculum, the child will perform well. The Schott Foundation, we're working on a report that we will release in January. It's a 50-state report that looks at just that. What is the probability that a child can access those resources by race and ethnicity? Some of the data that we've run on states says that indicates that there is for black and brown children, a 30% opportunity to learn in several states. So there's a 30% opportunity to learn, but there's the expectation of 100% outcome as measured by proficiency tests and all the rest. We've got to begin to develop a resource accountability standard that not only puts the accountability on children, teachers, and parents, but puts the accountability on governors and legislators to ensure that the students have the resources necessary to perform the high outcomes, because they can. They can reach the high outcomes. One of the things that were indicated in our report, Given Half a Chance on Black Males, on the performance of black males, the states where black males are performing and graduating at very high rates, North Dakota, Vermont, places where you have small black male populations, so small that they can't be relegated and isolated to under-resourced schools. And in those settings, they're performing at level, at on par, or even better than their white male peers. Alternatively, places where the schools are under-resourced, white males in Indianapolis, the graduation rate is 19%. White males in Detroit, the graduation rate is 17%. So the issue of performance is not a racial or ethnic issue. It is an issue of asking the question, why are so many black and brown children in underperformed school? That's why I believe that the compact is on point when it says that education has to be a constitutional right. It has to be a federal right, which can be achieved through a constitutional amendment, or it can be achieved through relitigating San Antonio versus Rodriguez. Now, what does all of this mean within a Obama administration? I think it means that we have to be more active as community advocates to get the work done. Obama started as a community organizer, as many of us know, but the process, the political process, was a shedding process to get to the White House. And I say that from this perspective. There are opportunities for President-elect Obama to talk about and provide some critique on personal responsibility and some critique on a subdominant culture. The speech he gave on Father's Day about black men being better fathers to help black children, and that was accepted. However, whenever there was an opportunity to critique a dominant culture, there was a pushback. When people are frustrated, they grab onto their guns and their religion. Pushback. Michelle Obama said, well, this is the first time I'm proud to be American. Pushback. I just don't believe that it is, this country is ready to have a minority candidate provide a critique of a dominant culture. And in that missing space, community organizations have to fill the void. Because while he's there with the vision and the opportunity, we have to be there with the critique. And one thing that he is, we have a president who's personally accountable to the people. So he will say, make me do it. Make me do it. That's why this meeting is so important. I agree with Tammy. This is a new day. But whether or not this is a new agenda depends on the work that we do. Thank you.
Remind me never to speak after Dr. John Jackson. I said to Rinku, I'll give you $20 if you put me last. And then she said, oh, sure, but you're going after John, so thanks. I just wanted to just do a quick acknowledgement to Megan as timekeeper, because I've never been on a panel where everybody has stuck to their time limits. So props to Megan in the front. Okay. That was my way of buying an extra minute. Anyway, so I'm here to talk about the economy, and what I see is a profound moment of opportunity. And because I'm somewhat of a cynical New Yorker, I am not speaking about Senator Obama's election, but about our economic crisis. And as our incoming chief of staff, Rahm Emanuel, with whom I never agree, says, a crisis is a horrible thing to waste. And I agree. This economic crisis provides us with a profound opportunity to talk about racial and economic justice, if we don't waste it. To date, we are having a conversation about the economic crisis as if we are spectators in a sports event that is taking place in D.C. You know, will Senator Obama send advisors to the economic summit? Who will he appoint as Treasury Secretary? Well, this is not a sporting event, and so we need to engage in this and open it up. Before I get into that, and in particular that and how it relates to the compact, I wanted to go back a little bit to my college days, which were too long ago. Whereas now I'm very shy and retiring, back then I was very aggressive. And you don't even know me. I don't know why you're laughing about that. But my girlfriend's laughing. She's in the front, hysterical. Okay, so Henry Louis Gates, who some of you may know, a very prestigious, preeminent scholar of African American studies and other things, a distinguished Harvard professor, was coming to the University of Chicago to talk about the black middle class and the arts. This was in the early 90s. And after his talk, I came up to him and I said, you know, don't you think it's somewhat misleading to talk about the black middle class in the way that you are? It's somewhat incomplete. There's no acknowledgement that the black middle class is significantly more fragile, that they are half the paychecks away from poverty than the white middle class, in possession of significantly fewer assets. You know, don't you think that's a conversation that we should be having? And he said, and I said, I mean, frankly, what's the value of calling it the black middle class if these distinctions are so clear? And he said, after trying to ignore me, of course there's a black middle class. Don't you watch The Cosby Show? And there you have it. Now, my point wasn't that there isn't upward mobility for the African-American community, but that there were such fundamental differences that perhaps it was more important to talk about the economic conditions that create those differences than to pretend that they weren't there. Mission accomplished. Thank God we won't have to see those banners anymore. And if we proclaim that those things are true, then there's nothing that we have to do about it. I'm a radical. I think that reality is the best place from which to make public policy. And so that's why I think this moment of today's economic crisis has so much potential for us. But the key is to figure out just how much reality we can unearth if we actually want to advance an agenda of racial and economic justice. So there's one reality that we know has been unearthed. Free market fundamentalism is no longer a viable sect of the capitalist religion. It's clear to everyone, I mean, including vast majorities of the American people, that we need a vigorous government to make sure that our economic system functions in a way that's consistent with our values. People voted on that in 2008 to elect Barack Obama to be our next president. You know, I think of the sign, rednecks for Obama, even we've had enough. and I think that it was, I didn't make it, it was a sign. Okay, and it was there. Deduct time for laughing. So now, for some of us, this was news. I mean, the former Federal Reserve Chief, Alan Greenspan, just had to explain at a Senate hearing that it was a fundamental flaw in his thinking that the free market couldn't regulate himself. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Ayn Rand, but he is a current, but this is my thing, is that from now on, whoever is interviewed before Congress to be a Federal Reserve Chief or Secretary of the Treasury, you need to ask, are you a current fan of Ayn Rand? Not in high school when everyone else is, but are you currently? Anyway, so for some of us, this was news, but for most of us, this was work that we've been doing for quite a long time. So this reality that the market is not best left to its own devices is clear. Our regulatory system collapsed. Our representatives, Democrats and Republicans from our communities, were captivated by industry and allowed them to have their way with our economy. But that's only one layer of the reality. The fact is that this economic crisis wasn't simply about the collapse of financial markets. Underlying this collapse was an economy in which there was profound economic inequality. So there were risky derivatives, there was the subprime fallout, but underlying this was the most profound economic inequality at levels that we have not seen since the Gilded Age. Record wealth amassed at the top, wages stagnant, the overall pie was growing, but the slices that went to wages of actual people was the smallest since they began recording these numbers 100 years ago. The prices skyrocketing, which we're all familiar with, education, health insurance, food, gas, all of that tied to industry. So after many fights to turn bad jobs into good jobs, we let our labor movement shrink. Our trade policy favored industry instead of people. So there was very little on which to base an economy that I would actually let themselves work their way up or hold on to their spot in the middle class. So that's another layer of reality. But there's more reality. The reality is that this inequality was reflective of an economic and a political system in which some people were significantly more fragile, marginalized, and excluded. African Americans continuing to make less on the dollar, have less to save, all the result of an ongoing discrimination that we need to unearth and acknowledge, a failed educational and criminal justice system that indicted millions to economic failure. Unauthorized immigrants are the drug that fed the addiction of industry for cheap labor. Women taking on unprecedented roles in the new economy while making less, but still asked to maintain their primary role as caretaker with no support. The U.S. being one of two nations, along with Swaziland, that doesn't offer paid leave after birth. It used to be the U.S., Swaziland, and Papua New Guinea, but they changed their policy. For all of us, this economic reality, this crisis, is newly painful. But for most of us, this economic reality of racial injustice has been a dull ache for a very long time. So the opportunity. How many realities will we unearth? We can't just talk about the collapse of the free market system. We can't stop by being angry at Wall Street. We can't even stop by saying there was economic inequality. For whom? Why? For how long? Now, moving on to the 1 minute sign. Okay. So some thoughts about what we need to do. One, we need to be bold in talking about these realities. Let's not let the storyline end where people are comfortable for it to end. Two, we need to respond to this economic crisis in a systemic way. I was briefing progressive members of the New York State Senate. I'm not going to name names, but I will if you see me later. But we were talking about this, and we were talking about the economic crisis, and one of the state senators who Latino represents a Latino community said, you know, we need to go out and we need to do financial literacy in these communities. We need to empower people to make better decisions. And I said, well, actually, you know, that's just where the right wing wants you to be. They want to have a conversation about people, how people's illiteracy caused this, instead of the systemic structure of greed and perverse incentives that created the situation. And he said, well, I'm not going to let my people be victims. And we are only victims if we don't deal with the system that created this crisis in the first place. Three, communities of color and women have been the canary in the coal mine for a long time. We need to figure out how to insert those voices, not just on the streets protesting, but in the policy-making conversation. Some of us need to get our booties to D.C. One of our fellows from whom you spoke, from whom you heard, Mark Winston Griffith, he's been a community activist and organizer, has been writing about the subprime crisis for 3 years, not for 3 months. That's what happens when you have people on the front lines engaged in the policy-making conversation. And last, going forward, we need to not let anyone define for us what economic success is. We bought into the home ownership line, hook, line, and sinker, that the American dream was defined by home ownership. We need to engage in our own conversation about what the American dream means, or our communities will suffer the consequences. So this economic collapse, and I know you're not supposed to make earthquake jokes on the West Coast, but it wasn't just a sudden implosion. It was a slow and steady unraveling of a weak foundation with then a shock to make it truly collapse. We need to not just talk about that shock. We need to talk about that foundation. And I think that's what the compact that ARC has produced allows us to do. And I think cynically, but importantly, that this crisis offers us an opportunity to talk about economic and racial justice if we are bold enough to have that conversation. Thank you.
Thanks. I'm going to stand because it's actually less blinding up here, the lights. Yeah, well, you know, I'm the big experimenter on this panel. Okay. And I'm actually Megan's boss, and so if she cuts me off, I'm firing her. Actually, that reminds me that this is the last time I'm going to be up in front of all of you and all together today, and I just have to say that I can't imagine any executive director who would be prouder of her staff than I am today. So, to give a little shout out to the ARC staff. Let me ask you all, how many of you have moved away from the place where you were born to go somewhere else, to study or to work or to do something? To me, that looks like about 100% of us. And that is going to be true in virtually any group of people that you find because human beings migrate. That is what we do. We do it to find better conditions for our lives and, you know, whether that's economic conditions or a job or better housing. But we also do it for adventure and love. We do it when we fall in love. We do it to be with our families. We all move around so we can be together. Many of us find a great sense of excitement and adventure and activity in that moving. So migration is a core human urge. We have been doing it ever since we walked on two legs, possibly before that, if we were human beings then. You know, I like to attach us to, I believe in evolution, yeah. All right. So human beings do it, and right now, in the U.S., as in the entire world, every country in the world is dealing with the problem of immigration and migration, either on one end or the other, either on the end of sending people away, because that becomes the primary economic development engine of our country, or from the end of receiving people, because we want their cheap labor and make some accommodations for them. So most countries of the world, including this one, the United States, has a pattern, a very destructive pattern of migration that's extremely 20th century and that isn't really working very well for anybody. And that pattern is this. You make legal immigration very difficult and bureaucratic. You set preferences for certain kinds of people that you want, and you leave the people that you do not want on the non-legal end, knowing full well that those people are still going to come anyway and give you a supply of cheap labor because it's illegal, unauthorized, undocumented. Your idea about the future flow of people coming into the country is that they still will be mostly undocumented. Legal immigration is going to remain very difficult. And so then you play out the entire pattern over again. So in the United States, we have done this now numerous times. In the last 100 years, we did it in the 1930s and the 1960s, the 1980s, and now here we are doing it again. And the way we do our current debate on immigration is that there are two positions, right? There are two mainstream positions. This is not how everybody thinks, but it's what you hear about on CNN. So on the one side, it's all about punishment. How do you stop them from coming? You punish, punish, punish. You build a big wall on the border. You arm men. You let vigilante groups run around and don't, you know, make them illegal. You just think of all kinds of ways to punish them. And essentially, who do we punish in this country? We punish so-called criminals. So on that end of the debate, it's all about the immigrant as criminal. On the other end of the debate, the, shall we say, liberal end, what we get is the discussion is all about the immigrant as worker. So all we're trying to do there is enable work. And all we're really trying to do there is enable employers to be able to get their cheap labor a little more easily than they could before. So either way, whether we're treating immigrants as criminals or treating immigrants only as workers, we dehumanize immigrants. Immigrants are not criminals, and they're a lot more than a pair of arms available for picking and hauling and scrubbing. Getting hot, I have to take my jacket off. Sometimes I excite even myself. All right. Don't say it. All right. So all of our related policies and programs revolve around those two options, and there are no others. You can't talk about immigrants as parents. You can't talk about them as cultural actors. You can't talk about them as having any kind of role to play in our civil society or in our politics. You know, they don't have rights. So we dehumanize immigrants, and we do this in an extremely racialized way. So I don't know, have any of you ever gone by a corner, a street corner, where day laborers were waiting and seen a pack of Irish undocumented people standing there waiting to be hired? No, they have a whole other system for getting their day labor deal done. Has anybody ever heard of an ICE raid happening in a meatpacking, or actually a construction site is much more likely at a construction site, and all the Irish undocs being packed off, you know, in shackles with dozens of cops and ICE agents around? No. So there's a very clear idea that we have about who belongs in the country and who doesn't. And regardless of what their actual status is, it's their skin color that determines how they're going to be enforced. So there is actually no way to do immigration enforcement under this framework without racial profiling. It requires racial profiling in order to work. So our immigration system, the way it is now, generates more racism. Don't give me that 1 minute sign because I have a lot more to say. So just hold it for a few minutes. All right. Executive privilege, we'll call it. Okay, so what do we lose by having this narrow mode of thinking? One, we lose the full possible contributions of immigrants, all of the political contributions that they can make by organizing, all of the cultural contributions they can make, because I know we don't all want to be eating porridge three meals a day, and all of the social contributions they make by building families here, all different kinds of families. And the second thing we lose is the chance to figure out the solutions that could actually make life better for everybody, both for the immigrant, well, there are going to be three categories here, for the immigrant, for their families that they have left behind at home, the people who are not yet migrating, and you know, many of whom might not actually want to leave where they are, and for the residents who are here in the U.S. already. So there is a different way, but in order for us to figure out what that way is, we have to deal with three very important realities. The first reality is that we have a globalization that is not fair. Corporations are able to move around absolutely freely. They are rewarded for crossing borders in order to find the most favorable conditions, which usually means low labor standards, no unions, and no environmental laws. And when human beings try to do the same thing, move across borders in order to improve their lives, they are then met by the men with guns standing at the border. So we have an unfair globalization, and so no matter how many punitive things we come up with, for as long as we have such differences between the wealthy countries of the world and the poor countries of the world, people are going to continue to migrate whether or not they have authorization to do that. The second important reality is that cultures always change. They always change. You cannot keep a culture unchanging and pure, so-called pure. And there's a thread of our immigration debate on the anti-immigrant side that is fixated on preserving American culture. You know, it's always talking about how those immigrants don't speak English and they, you know, pack 20 family members into one tiny apartment. And oh, that's such an un-American idea. And they, you know, they cook strange food, and they're so not American, they're so foreign that they're actually, oh, ultimately not really even human. So we have to fight that assumption with a different one, which is that cultures always change, no matter where you are, and keeping it static is not an option. So if it's going to change, then we have the option of driving those changes in a positive direction. And then the last reality is that U.S. residents and immigrants and people around the world, we have the same set of interests. We all want to be able to have a job that allows us to live with dignity. We want decent educations for our children. We want to be able to preserve our lives and our health. And we want to be able to practice our cultures, our changing cultures. So if we acknowledge those three realities, then that leads to a whole new approach to our immigration program. In that approach, the first thing to do is to decriminalize immigration, to separate the image of the immigrant from the image of the criminal. We need to take the Immigration Service out of the Department of Homeland Security, where it has only lived for 7 years. It hasn't always been that way, and it used to be called the Immigration and Naturalization Service, and now it is called the Immigration and Customs Enforcement. So we need to reverse that trend and go back to the service mode, take it out of Homeland Security. We need to expand legal immigration so that essentially people who want to come can do so legally. And we need to guarantee the full rights, full protection of people's labor rights and their civil rights. But that's not going to be quite enough because no matter how easy we make it to move around, we're still going to be having this real inequality between countries. And in order to change that, we have to fix globalization. we have to push for a new form of not just economic globalization, but also political globalization, so the people, the regular people of the world, can actually make decisions and hold both corporations and governments accountable transnationally. So, go ahead. You don't have to clap for me at the end, because, you know, you can just do it all along the way. Had we had such a system, had we had, for example, a North American Union that was a people's government joining Canadians, the U.S., and Mexico with the idea of adding in the Caribbean as soon as we could, and ultimately linking up various regional governments to create a global government, then we could begin to have global labor standards, global taxation systems, and global health and welfare systems that could actually begin to make immigration a choice rather than an act of desperation that people have no other recourse to. So, you know, when you go out talking about this, people will call you an open borders nut. And I'm willing to take it. I'll be the crazy open borders lady. I don't care, because I can tell by looking at reality that this is the direction of the world. We are going to be one world. And in fact, in many, many ways, we already are. So both our immigration policies and our globalization policies, our foreign and economic policies, have to have all of our engagement so that we can both make immigration a choice and make it recognize that it's a basic human right that we need to protect. There are a couple of things I just want to wrap up by saying people here can do. The first thing is to stop using the word illegal. Just stop using it. And every time you hear it, tell the person, I don't use that word, and here is why. I'd like you not to use it as well. So we have to start changing the way people think about immigrants, and one way is to do that. The second thing is to always talk about why people are coming. It's not like someone wakes up one day and says, oh, I think I'll cross a border today and work for slave wages somewhere else with no rights and give up all my rights. That's really not what happens. And then the third thing that we need to do as we begin to revive the immigration policy debate in this country is to demand a racial impact analysis of every single proposal that gets put out, whether it's by an advocate, an organizer, a politician, or anybody. Thank you so much.
Is this a hot panel or what? Yeah. So we're going to start our Q&A. I'm going to throw out the first one, but there are cards being passed around that will be brought up to me. I want to fast forward a little bit with this panel. Let's say we are in 2010 and it's the congressional midterm elections, because we will be there before we know it. What would we have done? What's the work that needs to be done between now and then to move us forward, to make all of these big, grandiose ideas that we have that we think can be real? I think they can be real. How are we going to make that happen? What kind of policy making would have need to have been done? What kind of messages in the media, not only in the mainstream, but in our community, how we talk and interrelate to each other would have needed to have echoed out from the bottom up? What is our base building and our movement building? What does that look like? And what are we poised to do in that period? We're in the midterm, and we want to take yet another step forward. What does that look like?
John's going first.
Well, I think it starts with us at the grassroots level clearly articulating what is it that we want. What is it that we want to have accomplished? How much does it cost, and how we're going to pay for it? I think one thing we have to be clear about at the federal level, specifically in education, that these are tough times. It's going to require tough choices and smart investments. And one of the smartest investments out there is education. For every dollar spent, there's a $4 return. Now it's not the time to balance the budget. Now is not the time to pay down the national debt. In fact, and I think we just have to make that clear and plain. In fact, the national debt as compared to the gross domestic product, which is our national income, is at 40% now. It's been higher. Through much of the 90s, it was at 50%. After World War II, it was at 109%. So we have room to make smart investments on things like education, healthcare, where there is a back-end return. We've got to be clear and unified in making that message, or putting that message out there. And at the state level, I think we have to begin to not only participate in the program discussions, but also the revenue discussions. Because if you, I joked yesterday, when I go to the program meetings, they look like this room. When I go to the revenue meetings, they look totally different. A white male meeting and the discussion, that's where a lot of the decisions are being made. And on their face, the decisions are race neutral. In Massachusetts, there was a ballot initiative to get rid of the state income tax, which is 40% of the revenue. If you get rid of 40% of the revenue, you don't have to talk about race or social programs because you don't have the resources to do it. Our program director, Linton Bolio, went around the state, was able to mobilize a number of organizations to defeat that ballot initiative. Those are the types of decisions and those are the types of recommendations I think we have to make.
I just, well, on my subject, the economy, the next 2 years are going to be quite rough. But I want to say one thing. I've been hearing it all over, and it's something that all of us need to actively resist if we want in 2010 to have some improvement that would prevent some kind of contract with America type of thing. Everybody that I'm hearing is saying President Obama will need to govern from the center. Have you heard this? Including on election night when, and I never agree with James Carville, but he turned to the right, to the conservative Republican next to him and said, are you giving us advice tonight? Because as far as I understand, you know, we're whipping you. But if we are, so Tammy, you asked about messages, and I think there is a clear mandate here. People in the election, but also in the time leading up to the election, wanted a progressive response. They wanted a government that is going to figure out health care, that's going to figure out how to increase and protect their wages. They want to make it easier for them to join a union because they know that is the best chance they have for a decent income and for decent wages and benefits. So I think in terms of from a messaging perspective, we need to control this conversation. And in particular, when it comes to the economy, we need to make it clear that people want something bold and progressive. They don't want any kind of piddling, you know, half-ass steps. And that means that in the next 2 years, President Obama is going to have to do health care. He's going to have to do progressive taxation. And he's going to have to do something about energy. And all of us have to insist that he does those things and that anything less is not acceptable. From our perspective. So we can't just, you know, okay, he's there. From our perspective, those things have to be done. But also, I know you asked about the midterms in just 10 seconds. As John said, on the local level, this stuff is going to play out in serious ways. You know, in my state, in New York, with our first African-American governor who says, I will sooner cut education by billions, healthcare by billions. I will not increase taxes. That is not an acceptable response. So I know we're all focused on DC because of what's happening, but we need to be focusing on what the next 2 years of state and local policy are making, or they are going to devastate our communities if we're not vigilant.
I just wanted to add one short comment. I do think that one thing from a broader civil rights, social justice, racial justice frame that we need to be very vigilant about in the next 2 years is we cannot let the dominant frame become that because Barack Obama was elected president that the civil rights battle is over, that racial justice has been achieved. And as thrilled as I am to have him in office, I am afraid that that will become a dominant frame in the media and in institutions that hold power. So I do think, it's not really a direct response to Tammy's question, but I think we have almost our work more cut out for us to make sure that these issues do not fall off the radar.
I just wanted to add that when I've been in the church basements and grubby rooms across the country talking to leaders recently, everybody's been saying you got to keep us in the rooms too. So there has to be some way to connect the conversation that happens in neighborhoods to the conversation in DC. And we don't do it very well now. We need to admit that. We need to build on what's out there.
I think that there's a lot that needs to be done, but from an immigration perspective, I think the most important thing to do is actually change the public dialogue on immigration so that we can move in the direction of deciding that a free flow of human beings is what makes the most sense, and then we can start to figure out technically how that would actually work. But until, you know, so if you run around now and say, you know, we want to open the borders and we're going to make globalization fair too, people are going to think you're crazy, and they're going to call you crazy by asking you lots of specific questions, you know, well, where would you cross on the border? And, you know, what about the people who come in on airplanes and stuff like that? And I think it's important for us not to get sucked into that kind of deflective discourse, which is really about shutting us down, but rather to stay focused on why people are moving around and on why not having a hugely exploitable, huge group of exploitable workers is, why not having that huge group is better for Americans as well, who are already here, because whenever you have such exploitable labor, then you're going to have an erosion of labor standards that and of organizing. So I think the most important thing to do is to change the way we talk about immigration so that we can start to set a really different vision against which all of the sort of legislative compromises of the next couple of years will be evaluated.
So many good questions, it's hard to choose, but I'm going to pick this one. How do we create solidarity between and among movements, particularly among racial equity, immigrant rights, and social class movements such as labor in this fight?
I mean, I think one thing, yeah, that's hard, but I think one thing is we have to start organizing for each other's priorities. So, you know, I've said to labor, you know, you want everybody out there on, I mean, I remember a conference, a big progressive gathering 2 years ago, there were two marches happening. One was the Employee Free Choice Act, you remember? One was the Employee Free Choice Act, and the next one was an immigrant rights march. Everybody was out for the Employee Free Choice Act march, labor, everybody was organizing. Nobody came to the immigrant rights march the next day. If we actually want, you know, we need to practice it. We need to model it. So we're going to have to be out on the streets for each other's priorities to demonstrate coalition, not just talk about coalition hypothetically. And that means we're going to have to hold each other accountable. I mean, the labor for sure is going to be pushing the Employee Free Choice Act, and we need to make sure that they will be as active, for example, when it comes to, you know, pursuing a progressive immigration policy that begins with giving legal status to those who are here. So I think we have to model the coalitions and think, you know, what should I do today that isn't in my silo? You know, and that's something I think we can do individually as well as institutionally. But I know John has all the answers.
Fair?
No, go ahead.
No.
I think I've said this earlier, and I just wanted to echo the comments I just made that, I mean, we really do have to learn how to work outside of our immediate area of work. And I think in my organization, we've been trying to do that. And I will actually say the frustrating thing is to have people constantly ask me. I identify as an ally, and I've had to explain for more than 3 years now, why am I working on an issue that people view as a gay rights or LGBT issue? And that should not be the question. The question should be, you know, how can we work together more? And so I mentioned the lawsuit we filed yesterday, and a big reason for that, the two reasons. One is that, you know, we have gays and lesbians in our community, so our issues are not separated. So we have to stand up for everyone in our community, not just for part of our community. But the other part of... Thank you.
But the other part of it is that we have to look at threats to any one part of our struggles across this broad spectrum, are threats to each of our individual struggles. So I mentioned earlier that in this particular case, what we've done now is stripped rights from a group of people that the Supreme Court in our state has said is protected. And now, you know, it's that, well, who's next, right? If we don't stand up, we do also have a self-interest. And so I think that we do, I mean, I think the answer is we have to work together more, and we also have to challenge people when they say, well, why are you working on someone else's issue? It's not someone else's issue. All of our issues are collective.
I guess I don't think we've yet developed a common frame. And when I say that, I think about instances over the past few years where the right has successfully used a common frame to move their agenda. I mentioned yesterday, for those who are pro-defense, pro-military, the opportunity to move your agenda was 9/11. And they did. From 9/11, there was a sweeping piece of legislation, the Patriot Act, a new administrative body, Homeland Security, $600 billion for a war. If a bird fell out a tree, it had something to do with terrorist activity. There was a common message, a common frame. For those who are anti-poverty, promote social growth, we've had our opportunities too. Katrina, what piece of legislation did we get? What administrative body was created to address it? I go back to Louisiana and think about the issue of Gina 6, where there was a massive mobilization, but there were a couple of young men whose sentences were reduced. Why wasn't that a discussion about federal policy on juvenile detention and all the rest? There has to be a common frame that we're speaking of, because from that common frame, it allows us to articulate what we're asking for and how we expect for it to be paid for. So where Wall Street was able to develop a bailout amount, if we are able to articulate what we want and how much it costs, we then, while Congress still has its checkbook open, can then make our bailout requests in order to turn things around.
I think as organizers, we also have to remember that issues are a construct that we made up, that when people live in the neighborhoods and they have low wages and they go to a grocery store that doesn't have any fresh greens or good food, or they are exposed, live by the highway and, you know, have smoke in their face, that all of these things impact their quality of life. And they think about making change and increasing and changing the quality of their lives. And we need to get back to the holistic way that we live and know that we're acting on all of that together.
Let's have a hand for our panel. Before we wrap up this portion of the morning, I want to take a few minutes to talk about where we go from here. I'm sure that's on the minds of many of you out there. The Compact for Racial Justice, an agenda for fairness and unity. How do we make this more than just a tagline, but a living idea that lives in our work, lives in our conversations with each other, lives in the policy we make, is part of our lived reality. To make our vision a reality, we need to move government to protect our rights, to protect and enforce and expand our rights like it did decades ago. That is why the first demand that ARC puts forth in this compact is the reconstitution of the Office of Civil Rights, to do that job, to do its job. And whether it's on the job, at the school, or at the border, we need an OCR that steps up and takes action to preserve everyone's rights. So that's the first order of the day. Because most racial disparities are preventable, the second demand we have coming out of the compact is the development of what we're calling racial impact statements at every level of government. When a law is passed or even being contemplated, we need to ask the question, what is that law going to do to or for our communities? How is it going to help all of us move forward? And that's what racial impact statements are about. And we need to ask those questions and demand that our leaders, whether they're in city council, state legislature, or in Congress, to ask those questions about how these laws are going to help or harm our communities. And finally, we're demanding that immigration reform be placed back on the table for public debate. And first and foremost, that means the ICE raids have to end. Then we need to move forward and have a real honest discussion about fundamentally changing immigration law in this nation. But really, that conversation and how this is going to happen is really not just about who's president or who's in Congress. We at the Applied Research Center know from working with you for over 26 years now that that kind of change happened because of your work or what you do on a daily basis. You make that difference. And history tells us that leaders, no matter who they are only as good as the mandate that we echo up and out to them. Our demands should not be silenced. They should be heard, and they should be inescapable. To every politician, to every person, the demands should be clear. It's our voice, it's your voice, it's our community's voice that really matters in this. So there are three things that we're asking people to do today to create this mandate for racial justice. The first, we need you to raise your voice and really support the Compact for Racial Justice. We're asking you today to sign a pledge to make this happen, to make a commitment to racial justice, to making a movement for racial justice in this country that connects all of our issues, all of our aspirations and visions together. Second, we need all of our organizations. This is a movement building opportunity. And that means the resources and the time and the energy of what you do every day in your organization, we need to bring that together and ask them to endorse the Compact for Racial Justice. And finally, because we know people need tools, we heard that even today, and how we even talk about this and move this forward, we need you to go online and download the toolkit for the Compact and spread the word about the movement. So this is going to be one of those unusual moments where a person at the podium asks you to take out your cell phone and turn it on. And at this moment, I do want you to make the pledge to support the Compact for Racial Justice. So the text message number is 41411. You write CAST support, followed by your full name and information, and hit send. And you just got involved with the Compact for Racial Justice. And as the Director of Strategic Partnerships, know that you'll be getting a call, an email from me saying, we're going to move this. Are you with me? So I just want to ask, we're going to move this. Are you with me? Are you with me? Thank you so much.